the stars are bright. You may not find gold or silver, but a richer prize waits for you behind the raindrops if you close your eyes. Tonight, when all the world's asleep, we will tiptoe home with a wondrous star, a star you can always keep. And years from now, when you're dreaming, when you're very old, though your crown be rich with rubies, diamonds set in gold, none will shine as bright as the star we'll find to.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Sketch MacQ Reads to You. I'm going to adjust the mic just a tad. And there we are. Sorry about that. We're in the middle of Hellboy, the Lost Army. Dang it. Well, that's ruined. We're in the middle of Hellboy, the Lost Army. To pick up, Hellboy is now in the middle of the Egyptian desert looking for a group of researchers who went missing. And my apologies to Indian persons who were raised in England, and most other accents I will attempt. The year was 525 BC, Arun began. Egypt was at war with Persia, and they were losing. The Persian king, Cambyses, was an extraordinary military leader, among other things. But it wasn't enough for him to have Egypt's metropolitan areas, to have the pyramids and the Nile. He wanted it all, the greedy bastard. That year, Cambyses sent 50,000 soldiers on a trek across the Sahara to claim an oasis city. According to the Greek historian Herodotus, near the end of their 600-mile trek, a hurricane-force sandstorm blew up and swallowed the army. 50,000 men, their supplies, their armorers, and animals, vanished. In 2,000 years, no one has ever found a single trace of the lost army of Cambyses, Arun concluded.
50,000 men, huh? Hellboy asked, mulling it over. Are we sure this happened?
As sure as we can be, Arun replied. It could be historical hyperbole, but after that, Cambyses never seemed to be quite so in command of his empire.
Let me guess. We're sitting on the spot where the army disappeared? Hellboy asked.
As near as we could determine, yes, Anastasia confirmed.
Of course, Hellboy sighed. He thought about what Arun had told him, and considered the disappearance of the archaeological team as a factor. Finally, he shrugged. I don't know what I can do, really, to help you out, he said. But the way I see it, you've got only two options. Anastasia looked at him expectantly. He glanced at Arun and saw that the man wore an identical expression. Well, it's just my opinion, remember, but either that story is all crap and we're all out here for no reason whatsoever, except to find some poor saps that wandered off or committed some mass suicide or something. Or there actually was an army that got swallowed up by the desert, he explained.
You actually believe that's possible? Arun asked. I mean, I know the history. I don't know what to believe.
I've seen some things that made a believer out of me, Professor, Hellboy said. As for you, well, you've seen me, haven't you?
Indeed,
Arun answered thoughtfully.
Nothing is impossible, Hellboy declared. That's the first thing I learned when I started to do field work for the Bureau. Nothing is impossible.
So what could have done that? Some enchantment or something?
Anastasia asked. Hellboy winced at the skepticism in her voice. She had seen her share of weirdness when they had been together. But such things were always hard for people to accept at first.
Maybe, he answered. Or maybe giant sandworms like in Dune, but I doubt that. Look, the way I figure it, if anything paranormal happened here, it comes down to annoyance, Hellboy said. Your friends probably stuck their noses where they didn't belong and somebody got pissed off. Why don't we start looking at it from that angle?
So you believe we could find them? Anastasia asked.
No, Hellboy admitted. Look, your lost army was 50,000 guys and nobody ever found any of them. When you take that into consideration, our chances don't look too promising.
Am I streaming? I'm live. Nobody's jumping in. Wait, who am I? Switching into public won't help, but oh well.
When you take that into consideration, our chances don't look too promising.
The three of them fell silent, watching as the cook twisted four more pigeons on spits over the open flames. After a moment, they heard a commotion among the edge of the camp.
Anastasia! Somebody yelled. That's Larry Scott, she explained. One of our search squad leaders.
He sounds excited about something, Hellboy observed.
Larry ran to Anastasia, tripped in the sand, fell face first on the desert floor. He looked up at them and recoiled slightly when he saw Hellboy. The man shook it off quickly, and Hellboy remembered that they had all been warned to expect him. All but Cregan and his bone crushers.
What is it, Larry? Anastasia asked. Why are you so out of breath? Where did you run from?
From the oasis, Larry replied, still breathing heavily.
He stared up at Anastasia.
Stacy, he wheezed. We found them.
Transitional music. Just under a mile northwest of camp, even closer to the Libyan border, lay a freshwater oasis several hundred yards in diameter. It was almost a crater in the middle of the desert, a deep depression with stone and earth walls that sloped steeply down from the sand to the edges of the small forest that surrounded the lake at the center of the oasis.
Wow, Hellboy mumbled.
Indeed, Anastasia said. Intellectually, you may know that they exist, but seeing an oasis, particularly one of this size, is still nearly a surreal experience.
It just doesn't look like it belongs here, Hellboy observed, glancing around the arid desert as they began their descent into the oasis depression. It's like somebody planted this huge garden in the middle of nowhere.
Am I getting a message about my feed? Go away, Bixby Home. Nobody likes you. Nope. All right.
It's like somebody planted this huge garden in the middle of nowhere.
And yet you find them all across the desert. Few and far between, true, but there nonetheless,
Professor Lahiri said. Their jeep bounced down the steep incline, tires tearing into dirt, finally getting traction after weeks on the sand. Hellboy gazed out across the blue expanse of fresh water and nodded slightly in amazement as he realized the extent of the oasis. The land around the lake for 40 or 50 yards was truly verdant, almost lush. Where the green stopped, the soil began. He was amazed the desert didn't simply overtake it all. Apparently, the high walls around the oasis protected it from the Sahara. Something distracted him far off to the left. He glanced in that direction and searched the hillside for some sign of movement. Nothing moved, but after a moment, Hellboy identified what had drawn his attention. The side of the hill seemed stained with several dark spots. Then he realized what those spots were.
"Are those caves?" Hellboy asked.
"Your eyesight is incredible," Arun commented. "As far as we can tell, there was once a clan of cave dwellers that lived on the banks of this oasis. It isn't on any map I've seen, but I believe it's probably the oasis of Ammon, which was previously considered to be merely a myth."
"But nobody lives here now?" Hellboy asked. "Why?"
That's an excellent question," Anastasia replied. "It certainly would sustain a small village or town, but few people even among the nomads would be hardy enough to make the trip to the nearest settlement for trade or communication without modern transportation, which the desert people just don't have access to."
"So, of course, we're out here in the middle of nowhere, where not even an Egyptian would want to be," Hellboy said sarcastically.
"It's the desert," Anastasia said and shrugged.
They reached the bottom of the slope, and Arun turned left to follow the outer perimeter of the oasis. The jeep rattled and wheezed, and Hellboy began to wonder if they would be able to make it back up the hill. Anastasia turned to glance back, and Hellboy followed her gaze. Cregan and several of his men had followed them in another jeep, guns at the ready.
"You know, I'm beginning to feel a bit useless here," Hellboy admitted. "You people seem prepared for just about anything, and more than capable of coming up with any strategy that might occur to me."
"That's where you're wrong," Anastasia said. "You're far more familiar with paranormal and how to combat it than anyone on my team. I don't know what we might run into, but I definitely want you around. Your instincts may be all we have to go on."
"I'm all fuzzy inside," Hellboy mused. "But at this point, you don't even know that there's anything paranormal happening around here."
A little more than 40 feet ahead of the jeep, a black woman shot from the trees and stood in their path. She waved at them frantically, and Arun swerved the jeep to the left and jammed on the brakes. The jeep shuddered to a halt.
"What happened to Larry?"
the woman asked. I don't know what her accent will be. Staring at Hellboy so vacantly that he could not even decide if she really were staring or just shell-shocked by what she had just found.
"He's resting, Jenny," Anastasia responded. "He really didn't want to see it again," he said.
"Can't blame him," Aunt Jenny said. "Soon as you guys have a look, I'm going to go back to camp. I don't even want to be near this oasis again, not after today."
I'm assuming she's British or something, I don't know. Still nobody logging in. It's weird. Oh, well. Hellboy got out of the jeep and stood with Arun and Anastasia as the men from M15 leaped out of their own jeep and ran up to meet them. Unlike most people, who would run at the first sight of something supernatural, Hellboy had made a career out of hunting down and investigating such things, often enough beating them senseless. That was his job. Yet, despite that such investigations often came to violence, the BPRD held the acquisition of knowledge as its main goal. The defense part was easy. Some paranormal being got out of line, the BPRD was there to take it down hard. But soldiers had a tendency to shoot first. Hellboy was always uneasy around any kind of military personnel. No matter how hard he was to kill, it didn't make him immortal. To send a numbskull like Cregan up against something paranormal was just asking for trouble. Hellboy didn't want to get caught in the crossfire.
"Let's go," Anastasia said, and tugged lightly on his arm. Her touch sent a wave of feeling through him, a protective affection that she had chastised him for in the time when their relationship was still intimate. She could take care of herself. He knew that. But it didn't mean he wasn't going to make absolutely certain that, no matter what else happened,
no matter the cost, Anastasia would be safe. While he was at her side, it was the least he could do. Cregan was at the head of the group as they cut through the trees and Hellboy glared at his back. Captain Cregan was a dangerous man, but he'd never met anyone like Hellboy before. Ahead, several more members of Anastasia's team were gathered at the edge of a small clearing. They stood in a tight group, speaking softly to one another. When Cregan arrived, they moved aside, and Hellboy felt Anastasia stiffen next to him. She might be in charge, but Cregan had the authority of his position, and of the crown behind him. Their conflict was bound to continue. Cregan and his men froze at the entrance to the clearing. Hellboy could smell the water from the oasis, which likely sprang from an underground reservoir or river of some kind. It was a sweet, fresh smell and welcome, but it was tainted. Tainted by blood.
"Oh, dear God!"
Anastasia cried. Across the clearing, the upper limbs of dozens of trees were strewn with gory decoration, red streamers that might have been the viscera of human beings. Half bodies hung from trees, leaking crimson ichor on the tall grass. Behind him, Arun Lahiri turned and vomited profusely between two tall trees. Hellboy ignored him and stared across the clearing. After a moment, Anastasia began to follow. He did not turn, but he sensed her approach and was proud of her. Cregan went with them in silence. They stood several feet from where the green grass was sprayed with blood and bone and other human matter. The bodies appeared to have been mutilated horribly, slashed to ribbons, and their remains strung about the trees with a revoltingly gleeful abandon. "How long ago did you say these people disappeared?" Hellboy asked.
"Come now," Cregan huffed. "How can we be certain this is even the team we're searching for?"
Hellboy frowned and turned to regard the square-jawed blonde man as though he were an idiot. "Now who else would it be?" he asked. "I guess you can tell the Queen her cousin won't be summering at Buckingham Palace this year."
"You disfigured Simeon Oaf!" Cregan cried. "How dare you speak of Her Majesty with such disrespect?"
"Put a sock in it, pal," Hellboy snapped. "You're not even supposed to be here, remember? You're invisible, a ghost. Why don't you start acting like one?" Cregan appeared to consider his response, but in the end said nothing. Part of Hellboy felt disappointed. He wanted to pummel the captain, but the BPRD frowned on him, causing international incidents. So it was all for the best. There is something wrong. Oh, well. "Several weeks, at least," Anastasia said, and the tension between Hellboy and Cregan dispersed. "At least temporarily." "What?" Hellboy asked. "Yeah, you know what? I'm going to stop now. Nobody's tuning in. That's enough for tonight. But for those listening to this pre-recorded, thank you for tuning in. And pleasant dreams.